In just a moment, another terrific Facebook Live performance from the WQXR studios. Please take a minute now to share this with your friends so they can watch the live stream along with you. Stay with us. A live performance from the studios of WQXR starts in just a minute. Stay with us. A live performance from the studios of WQXR starts in just a minute. Hi, I'm Jeff Spurgeon. Welcome to WQXR's Performance Studio and to our Facebook Live page for a very special Midday Masterpieces experience and a preview of a recital that's happening tomorrow night at Carnegie Hall. We have with us today one of the great virtuosos in the piano world. Marc-André Hamelin is in the studio with us today to play and talk about some of the music that he'll bring to his Carnegie Hall Live recital audience tomorrow night as well. He's one of the, as I say, one of the great virtuosos of the world, plays from the core of the classical repertory, but also seeks out some of the hidden gems and technically challenging pieces from a few side spots in the repertoire. So when Marc-André Hamelin is with you, you can count on hearing fabulous performances of works that you may already know and love, and then you've got some real treats coming in some other places too. We're going to experience all that today here on WQXR's Facebook Live from our studios, starting with Marc-André Hamelin and a Schubert impromptu. Thank you. Pianist Marc-André Hamelin with us in WQXR's performance studio here on Facebook. Thank you, sir. It was just wonderful.
Thank you. Good morning. Good afternoon, actually.
Yeah, whatever time it is, it's all times now. You know, we're all around the world. It's every time.
That's true.
You have recently released an album of Schubert on which this impromptu and the other impromptus has been recorded, and the big B-flat sonata. What, like your 50th album? Is that right? Your 50th recording?
On Hyperion, I mean, boring statistics, but I think it was like 57th or something like that. But I've also done over 20 on other labels before right. that, actually. So,
have you had an agenda about what you wanted to record when? How has that happened?
No. I mean, on some of the other labels, and most notably on Hyperion, I mean, I've had the great fortune of being able to do almost whatever I like. So I have to confess that I don't plan very well. So it's just a question, I guess, of a feeling that the time is right for certain things.
Why was the time right for Schubert this year, 2018?
Well, because I thought I'd waited quite long enough. I'd been performing the B-flat for about 20 years, and I'd been itching to put it on CD almost from the very beginning, but that would have been completely foolish. So I'm very glad I waited.
Isn't a recording at any time? I mean, it's just how you feel it now.
Oh,
right?
It's a frozen moment in a way. You know?
Yeah.
But you want it to be as lively and as full of life as possible, of course.
One of your great strengths, and you are one of the few pianists who does this, is that you are also a composer and a writer of amazing transcriptions of other works. A few years ago, you created a work for the Cliburn competition, the Cliburn Piano Competition, which you're going to share with us now. I'm thrilled to learn about, to be able to hear you play this Toccata, based on L'Homme Armé. It's a very old song.
Probably the oldest song in existence.
From the 1400s, 1300s, something like that.
I think it's 1400s, yeah.
And it's been the basis of many, many masses over a course of time. And you created a Toccata on this little tune, on a commission from the Cliburn organization for the competition. So everybody had to play it.
Yes, right. There were 30 right. contestants, and for the first time, actually, it wasn't just semifinalists who were required to play it. Everybody had to do it. So getting 30 premieres is the greatest gift for a composer.
Yeah, and being able to have 30 pianists with that work in their hands to take where they want to go. So when you started to write this, did you think of it as a competition piece, and how did you form it in knowing what it was going to be used for?
Well, I had had some sketches for it from a few years ago, but I didn't get very far with them. And when this commission came through, and I thought, well, this might be a good idea to... It just seemed like the right kind of piece to write for the competition.
Really. You were a judge in the competition, too.
Yes, I was, yeah.
Well, so how did... did that make your job easier or harder, knowing that they were playing music that you knew so intimately?
Well, I had a bit of a worry because, you know, I think every composer's worry is to be understood by their performers, you know. Morton Feldman actually had a wonderful line. He said, "I don't go to rehearsals of my music because I want to know what I'm going to sound like after I'm dead." So what he meant was that he wanted to know how his music would sound with no interaction from him, right. from himself. So of course, if a work will survive, you know, that has to happen, of course. So they had no input from me, as per the rules of the competition. All okay. they had was 2 months to learn the piece, right. and all of them did, at the very least, very well. Mm. I have to say, I'm of course, there were some divergences from what I intended, you know, and that's inevitable. And it's some willful eccentricities.
that's musical conversation. That's conversation with the composer.
Absolutely, and it happens all the time with any composer, of course. Right. So it was a tremendous educational experience for me.
So we're going to hear the piece now. This is a Toccata based on this tune from the 1400s, 1300s maybe, called L'Homme Armé, The Armed Man, performed by Marc-André Hamelin in WQXR's performance studios, just for you on Facebook Live. the saddest thing about these Facebook Live situations for the performers is they can't hear the applause. We know you're applauding. We know a piece like that inspires great accolades. That was the Toccata based on La Marmé, a tune from hundreds and hundreds of years ago. And Marc-André Hamelin played the piece that he wrote, commissioned by the Cliburn Organization for one of the Cliburn piano competitions just a few years ago. Bum, ba, 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 ba. If that comes back to you later today, Marc-André Hamelin's fault. You can blame him for that. It's a wonderful, wonderful piece.
Thank you very much.
You are also on your Carnegie Hall recital tomorrow night in Isaac Stern Auditorium. You are playing, let's see, Bach Busoni, a Busoni transcription of the Chaconne from the Violin Partita No. 2. Great big piece. Schumann Fantasy in C, sizable piece. A couple of works by Chopin. And I don't know these Castelnuovo Tedesco cypresses. The only cypresses I know are the ones that grow outside and the ones that Dvorak wrote. What are Castelnuovo Tedesco's cypresses?
Well, it's a single piece. It's about 8 minutes long, and it's inspired by a certain region in which he lived, I believe, you know, in which there were these beautiful cypresses, and that's really all it is. And I believe he orchestrated the piece a year later, but I haven't heard that yet. It's a marvelously impressionistic work, and I wish I had time to play it here, but I had to make a choice, of course.
No, that's wonderful.
It's a wonderful thing to discover. I mean, Castelnuovo Tedesco is a composer who we only know really from his guitar works. But he wrote so much more. You know that Aldo Ciccolini, the famous pianist, that recorded all of Castelnuovo Tedesco's work, piano works, and it's on 4 CDs. I don't think it's available here. It was done in Italy, but there's some marvelous things here. He wrote wonderfully for the piano.
That's wonderful to know. That's wonderful, because I don't know very much of his piano music either. Also, tomorrow night, you're playing something that has a wonderful story behind it. And this is... a set of, I don't know, I guess we should just start with Alexis Weissenberg, who was a great pianist, born in Bulgaria, had an amazing, extraordinary childhood experience going through World War II, studied at Juilliard, and had an incredible career. But France was sort of home for a long time, and no doubt that is where he heard one of the great 20th century pop troubadours, as maybe Charles Aznavour is to Frank Sinatra, so Charles Trenet was to Bing Crosby. Maybe,
something like that, yeah.
Maybe a little bit. One of the great French artists of the 20th century. And Weissenberg obviously encountered some of Charles Trenet's tunes and whipped up a transcription of some music that was associated with him. Now, the stuff wound up on a little piano file. People who love pianos and piano music knew about this recording. Tell us about this recording.
It's a 45 RPM sort of EP, you know, extended play.
If you don't know what a 45 RPM is, go ask your parents or your grandparents. They'll be happy to tell you about that.
It was. I think it came out in 1956. I mean, nobody knows exactly for sure, but I think he tossed this off at the end of a Liszt sonata session, if I'm not mistaken. It was in Belgium. And there were six of these wonderful, wonderfully creative arrangements. And for a while, nobody cared about this. I mean, it was a very, very obscure thing. You know?
Well, and his name wasn't on it. Weissenberg's name was not on the record.
The record was called Mr. Nobody Plays Trenet. He probably thought that the playing wasn't good enough, or he thought it might hurt his career to be known as Weissenberg on the record. In any case... these arrangements are really wonderful, and they show a great creative talent. And you know that he wrote at least two musicals.
No, I didn't.
Their production history, unfortunately, was not very successful. You know, but there's some wonderful music. I mean, there are some recordings of these things.
All right.
So when a friend of mine alerted me to the existence of these recording, this little record, you know, I was really smitten. And because there was no score at the time, or so I thought, I set out to write them down, which is not an easy task because the playing is, I mean, they're rather complicated arrangements, as you will see. I'll play three of them.
Right.
But it's finally doable.
So you transcribe them, and then, as so often happens when you take care of something that somebody's already taken care of, you find out after you've done it that they did it before you. So some of these scores were discovered.
Yes, four of the manuscripts actually turned out. So this gave rise to a publication. They're going to be published next month, these arrangements, by an outfit in Japan called Muse Press. And I'm very, very happy that this happens because I've been asked for these scores for such a long time. So they're finally available for pianists to enjoy.
All right, so we're going to hear three of these transcriptions by Alexis Weissenberg of songs associated with the French pop star of the 20th century, Charles Trenet. So these transcriptions were written down by Marc-André Hamelin, so he does have a hand in the work and two hands on the works right now for you from WQXR Studios. Oh, what wonderful treats we've gotten in this visit today by Marc-André Hamelin to WQXR Studios. Nobody else is playing these works. You're getting them from Marc-André Hamelin. He's the guy to go to.
I hope many will play it.
Well, it's a wonderful story, and we haven't told all of it. What you've been hearing are three songs from a set of a half dozen songs sung by Charles Trenet, transcribed by the pianist Alexis Weissenberg. And you, well, we have a couple of pieces to the story, and I really want to tell them. These, first of all, you're going to hear these tomorrow night at Carnegie Hall. Second, you got to play these for Alexis Weissenberg. Is that correct?
I played, I think, three of them. I think it was probably those three.
And you had transcribed them from this 45 RPM record, and then you got to play them for Weissenberg. What did he say?
Well, you know, by that time, you know, he was in quite an advanced state of Parkinson's disease,
yeah.
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
So there wasn't that much of a reaction, but I'll remember to this day, you know, this. He said, "Mais vous jouez toutes les notes," but you're playing all the notes.
Well,
which was quite kind of nice to hear. But
as you discovered in doing the transcriptions, that after you did the transcriptions, then
I saw the manuscripts, and then I realized that he had, there were quite a few departures from what he'd written, which is, I mean, it's popular music, of course, you should do that. what is going to happen, actually, because these manuscripts were found, this eventual publication next month is going to include both versions, whatever I heard from the recording.
Right.
And the manuscript itself, a transcription of the manuscript. So they're going to be bracketed together for people to compare.
That's just wonderful. Two other computer things that we should mention. You can hear Weissenberg's performance.
Yes.
At a site called 78experience.com.
Well, actually, the site is a is run by someone who does transfers of old recordings, 78 and otherwise, and he's released a CD of those, which you can buy there.
Okay, 78experience.com. Yeah. And then you had a little help in doing the transcription from a piece of software that I'd never heard about that's wonderful.
It was recommended to me, actually, because I don't know very much about these things. It was called the Amazing Slowdowner, and this allowed me to hear everything much more clearly. It slows down the music, but not the pitch.
So you have time to capture it before it goes away to the next
note. You can slow it down to an absolute crawl, and it answered so many questions.
Well, so this is part of the amazing journey of pianist Marc-André Hamelin. Speaking of journeys, he's going to Europe soon, Luxembourg, Amsterdam, I think, and some concerts in Germany between now and the end of the year.
And a recording session.
And what are you going to be recording?
The first six piano sonatas of Samuel Feinberg, who was a very, very interesting figure to come out of Russia.
Right.
Still very much neglected.
All right. So, once again, Marc-André Hamelin is composing, bringing to life music that has fallen into obscurity, and, of course, creating his own wonderful transcriptions of works, too. You'll get to experience him at Carnegie Hall tonight, but we're going to get one more performance from him. We'll conclude our time together today with a little bit of Debussy and some reflections on the water. Claude Debussy's Reflections on the Water, played by pianist Marc-André Hamelin, who will be performing tomorrow night, Thursday, November 15th, at Carnegie Hall Isaac Stern Auditorium, a program of Bach, Busoni, and Schumann, and Castelnuovo Tedesco, some of the Alexis Weissenberg works, in fact, all of them that you heard on this program, and some more besides, and music of Chopin, too. A fabulous evening at Carnegie Hall, preceded by an incredible Facebook Live performance here in our studio. Our little studio, Steinway, is so contented, gently wagging its una-quarta pedal back and forth. You can't see it, but it's happening. Marc-André, thank you so much. What a privilege to share this time with you.
Thank you, Jeff. It's been a pleasure.
Just great. All right, so listen, like this Facebook page, WQXR's Facebook page, and then we'll tell you when the next of these Facebook Live events is happening. I'm Jeff Spurgeon. Thanks so much for spending this time with us. Boy, wasn't it worth it? What a great, great time with Marc-André Hamelin. Thanks for watching.